Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Institute for Australian Chinese Arts and Culture at Western Sydney University. I'm Professor Jing Han, the director of the Institute. Before we start, I would like to acknowledge that we are on our Parramatta South campus, which is on the country of the Darug people of the Darug Nation, and acknowledge their ancestors who have been the traditional owners of their country for thousands of years. We also want to pay our respect to the First Nations elders of the countries we are all sitting on today, past, present, and emerging. Welcome to My China Story Special Edition. My China Story is a conversation series whose aim is to bring a deeper and a wider understanding of the multifaceted and humanized China through sharing lived experiences and knowledge of China by public figures of Australians from a wide range of professions. On 2nd of December 1972, the Australian Labor Party, led by Gough Whitlam, won its first national election in 23 years, and Gough Whitlam became the Prime Minister. On 21st of December, the Whitlam government recognized the People's Republic of China and established the diplomatic relations with China. Dr. Stephen FitzGerald, a China specialist at the age of 34, was appointed by Gough Whitlam, the first Australian ambassador to China. At the 50th anniversary of the diplomatic relations between Australia and China, the Institute for Australian Chinese Arts and Culture, in partnership with the Whitlam Institute, is holding this special edition of My China Story. And we are so privileged and honored to have Professor Stephen FitzGerald AO as our guest speaker. I just want to say a few words about the slideshow you just saw. Those incredible historical photos actually were not seen by many of us growing up in China. And the song accompanying the slideshow, the last one you just heard, is one of the most popular and loved songs in China. It was created in 1956, written by iconic poet and songwriter Qiao Yu, and composed by an equally famous musician, Liu Zhi. Originally was called A Big River, later changed to My Motherland. The song opens with the line, "There is a big river," for the reason that there is a river in many people's hometowns. So it is to make everyone recall memories of one's hometowns. And with the beautiful love story and idyllic scenery. It is a theme song from a film called Battle of Triangle Hill or Battle of Shanganlin during the Korean War. The very down-to-earth lyrics and traditional Chinese folk song melody are to soften the toughness and relentlessness of the war. Not surprisingly, the song was actually banned during the Cultural Revolution, but back on the top chart ever since. On January 19th, 2011, when American President Barack Obama received the Chinese President Hu Jintao in the White House, it was arranged that the pianist Lang Lang played this song. So when I asked Steve to pick a song for the slideshow, Steve picked a few, and including this one. So the selection of the song, this small detail, tells me again how deep and detailed Professor Stephen FitzGerald's knowledge of China and Chinese culture. For this special edition of My China Story, who is most suitable to give the opening speech but the director of Whitlam Institute, and my colleague, Professor John Durans. Prior to be the director of Whitlam Institute, John served as a deputy dean of the School of Law at Western Sydney University. And prior to that, he has worked as a lawyer with many major law firms and the Australian Law Reform Commission. Please welcome Professor John Durans to give the opening remarks. Please, John.
Thank you very much, Jing, and good afternoon. My name is Professor John Jurians, and I'm the director of the Whitlam Institute within Western Sydney University. It's my great privilege to welcome each attendee and to introduce a great Australian, distinguished fellow of the Whitlam Institute and professor at the Institute of Australian and Chinese Arts and Culture, Dr. Stephen FitzGerald AO, who will be delivering the special edition of the My China Story series. We are absolutely delighted he's able to join us this afternoon. It is an honor for the Institute, the IAC, and Western Sydney University to have him as speaker today. Today, of course, is the 6th of December, 2022, some 4 days and 50 years since the Australian people voted in the first Whitlam government, and just 15 days shy of the 50th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between Australia and the PRC. That is, this address marks the auspicious 50th anniversary of a new stage in the Australia-China relationship, inaugurated by the normalization of diplomatic relations between the Commonwealth of Australia and the People's Republic of China on the 21st of December, 1972. As we rightly do, we recognize and celebrate these auspicious days for their extraordinary impact on the political and cultural history of Australia and its emergent place of independence within the world. However, it may be a different date, the 4th of December, 1972, to be precise, that may be more properly commemorated here today. On this date, Gough Whitlam met with his foreign policy officials at Parliament House, an encounter Stephen FitzGerald recalls in his book, Comrade Ambassador, Whitlam's Beijing Envoy, at which time he directed them to instruct Ambassador Renouf in Paris to commence negotiations with his Chinese counterpart on the opening of diplomatic relations between China and Australia. The direction was quickly attended to. Whitlam had led on this front from opposition, having famously visited China in 1971, prior to Kissinger and prior to Nixon. Whitlam then instructed his diplomats that the UN General Assembly resolutions on Southern Africa were to be immediately reversed. In his book, Stephen recalls the reluctance amongst his officials who pressed him with the view that it would be precipitate to deviate from the norms of their Western allies. If there was to be a change in the vote, they suggested, it would be more prudent for Australia to simply abstain. Whitlam asked how our neighbors were going to vote. When the diplomatic officials started a response with the example of New Zealand, Whitlam interrupted and said, "No, I mean our new neighbors, the countries of the third world." This was a remarkable change. Under coalition governments, Australia had voted against UN resolutions critical of apartheid. That voting stance was a large part of Australia's international character. We voted for colonial powers. We voted to protect states institutionalizing racism. Our instincts were those of Crown Colony or Banana Republic. In one meeting, 2 days after being elected, Whitlam swept away that legacy. A different Labor leader may well have accepted this departmental advice. However, in Whitlam's words, he had promised to take Australia forward to a rightful, proud, secure, and independent place in the future of our region. Whitlam prioritized international affairs above all other areas. Whitlam's foreign policy contained multitudes of promise, creativity, problems and influence that would require thorough analysis, mature reflection on Australia's legacy, commitment to the region, and human rights enablement. Enter Dr. Stephen FitzGerald. Stephen was appointed by Gough, who was also the Minister for Foreign Affairs, the first Australian ambassador to China. He was, as Jing said, only 34, an external appointee who had never run an embassy. He was appointed because he was a China specialist. As ambassador to the People's Republic of China during the years 1973 to 1976, Stephen ran an embassy in Beijing at a time of unquiet, tension, and eventually dramatic upheaval, and not only in China. He did so with the assistance of a group of talented and committed foreign affairs colleagues. Together, they engaged with the China of the late Cultural Revolution era, with insight, energy, and dedication. It was also an embassy that engaged with the small and motley groups of Australian students studying in China from 1973. Stephen was born in 1938 in Hobart, where growing up, he didn't know a single Asian person until he went to university in 1957. At the University of Tasmania, he took George Wilson's history course on Asia, the first of its kind in Australia. In 1961, Stephen joined the Department of External Affairs, where he was asked to learn Chinese when he didn't know anyone who spoke Chinese. After studying for a year at the RAAF School of Languages at Point Cook and receiving his diploma of Chinese language, Stephen was sent to the language school at the University of Hong Kong. The school was set up at the behest of the British government, which had had diplomatic relations with China since 1949, to train its foreign office and defense officials, as well as officials from Commonwealth countries. While in Hong Kong, he made his first and fleeting trip to the forbidden mainland China in December of 1964 on a small freighter run by a Norwegian shipping line and visited Shanghai. The first-hand glimpse of Shanghai, fleeting as it was, further motivated Stephen to become a dedicated China specialist. While in Hong Kong, Stephen also made two trips to Taiwan, where he met the 78-year-old Chiang Kai-shek and his wife, Sun Mi-ling. Deeply disaffected with the coalition government's China policy and Vietnam policy, Stephen left the Department of External Affairs in 1966 and commenced his PhD studies at the ANU on contemporary China and its relations with overseas Chinese. As a part of his research, he went to Hong Kong again in July of 1967. From there, in January 1968, at the height of the Cultural Revolution, Stephen joined a group of 56 Australian and New Zealand students for a three-week tour of China. Upon receiving his PhD, Stephen became a research fellow at the Department of Far East History at the ANU in 1969. With them, the leader of the Australian Labor Party in opposition was an advocate of recognition of China and wanted to visit China before the election. On the 10th of April, 1971, 3 days before the Whitlam's cable was sent to Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai seeking an invitation, the US table tennis team and a group of American journalists arrived in Beijing, breaking a 22-year freeze in US-China relations. In July of 1971, Dr. FitzGerald was invited to join the delegation led by Whitlam as China advisor to visit China. On the 5th of July, Whitlam had the historic meeting with Zhou Enlai, which defined Australia's relationship with China for decades. Whitlam had his 55th birthday in China, and Zhou Enlai ordered a birthday cake with his special wishes. On the day Whitlam arrived in Tokyo with Dr. FitzGerald and the group still in China, it was announced that Henry Kissinger was in Beijing, and President Nixon would visit China shortly thereafter. The Australian coalition government was kept in the dark about the Kissinger visit and was hit by the Nixon announcement. In April of 1973, Dr. FitzGerald and his family arrived in Beijing on the 24th of April. He presented his letter of appointment to the acting president of China, Dong Biyu, the last living Chinese who had passed the old imperial exams under the Qing dynasty. On the 31st of October, 1973, Prime Minister Gough Whitlam led a 70-member delegation to China, the first by an Australian Prime Minister in history. Dr. FitzGerald was the only other person from the Australian side present when Mao Zedong, unscheduled, received Prime Minister Gough Whitlam at Zhongnanhai, a former imperial garden in the imperial city of Beijing, adjacent to the Forbidden City. His has been an extraordinary career. The early embrace of China has helped define modern Australia. Stephen FitzGerald's story as diplomat, a China scholar, and an advisor to Prime Ministers Gough Whitlam and Malcolm Fraser is interwoven with the wider story of modern Australia at a dramatic moment in our nation's history. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to invite Professor Stephen FitzGerald AO to deliver this special My China Story address. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Durant, and thank you, Professor Han. It's great to be here at this time to celebrate the 50th anniversary. I might recall that back in the 1970s, when China began mounting international exhibitions of its antiquities, these were known as Chutuwen Wu, unearthed relics. At an event in Canberra about 10 years ago, the chair of that event said to the assembled people that the benefit of me being so young when I was ambassador was that I was still around to talk about it. And I felt a bit like an unearthed relic myself. So, but here I am still, 10 years on from the time that remark was made. Jing asked me, suggested I might talk a little bit about what is China to me. And that's a very big question, but also easy to answer, I think. It's been my abiding interest since 1961, and of course, my profession for a lot of that time. But it's not just my profession. I love the history and the culture and the language and the people I've known, and of course, the food, from the high cuisine of banquets to the most basic. And I might recall a small anecdote from when we were in Beijing. I organized in a Chinese restaurant a dumpling eating competition. And so everyone from the embassy went to this restaurant and we had a dumpling eating competition. I didn't win, I'm pleased to say, but the person who did ate 73 dumplings. But by and large, together with my colleagues, we loved to go to small restaurants where you could get a bowl of noodles or a bowl of dumplings. And to some extent, rub shoulders with ordinary people. So what's my China story? The high point was obviously when I was ambassador in Beijing, and it was challenging and exciting. I've often been asked, was I overawed? No, I wasn't overawed. I was awed, but not overawed. And I'd sometimes wake up in Beijing thinking, what is a small town boy like me doing in a place like this and a job like this? And, you know, sometimes that was a kind of wonder to me how I came to be there. There were times also when I would wake up thinking that I had finally got to understand China. And the next day I'd know that I hadn't really got to understand it because there was so much. I was just really scraping the surface of understanding. We have to remember that at the time, the Australian people, government and officials as well, carried a number of stereotypes about China. And the first was the stereotype of culture that we inherited from the British. China was a fascination, but China was said to be inscrutable. So strange, mysterious over there, not capable of understanding it. On top of that, in Australia, you had the challenge of and the stereotype of ethnicity or race. China is the so-called yellow peril. And then on top of that, the fact that China was communist. And on the opposite side of Australia, in the Cold War and the Hot War in Vietnam. So the charter or the brief that we had was what was called the normalization of our relations. we had to cut through all of those stereotypes and start talking across the board. And I say our task, because as John mentioned, we had a young staff, most of them Chinese speaking, and we worked as a team. And because they were Chinese speaking and budding China specialists, every one of them was enthused and energized with each step we were able to take in normalizing our relationship. It was a wonderful environment in which to work. And I think it's in large part due to the dynamic of that group of people in the embassy that we were able to achieve as much as we did in the time that I was there and going on after that. So in a way, that's really the essence of what China is to me. But my China story, of course, began before that, and it continued on afterwards in many different roles and functions. As John has mentioned, I was in Beijing as ambassador because I was appointed by Gough Whitlam, who, by the way, also loved food. We were in talks with Joe and I one day, and Whitlam was always absolutely focused. But then about mid-afternoon, the staff arrived with small plates of little delicacies, you know, tiny dumplings and other things. And Whitlam was so distracted, he almost lost concentration, because here was a lovely little offering of food. And we enjoyed food together in many contexts. But Whitlam was, of course, an intellectual. And that was one of the things that I admired and appreciated about him most of all. And he also loved expertise in the people who advised him. And I believe that that's part of the reason why he decided to ask me to go to Beijing. This intellectual quality was reflected in all manner of ways in his work, but he was an incredible person to brief. He took it all in, not only remembered it, but it was all slotted into his wider worldview. Of course, what I was advising him on was China and China's foreign relations, but you know, he had an overall grasp of world affairs that I had not encountered in any other Australian politician. And to this day, I don't think any Australian politician, to the extent that Whitlam had this. I'll give you an example of that. When we had that famous meeting in Beijing in 1973 with Chairman Mao Zedong, they got into talking about the Soviet Union. And Whitlam said at one point, the Soviet Union has not always been a really good and helpful friend of China. I mean, Mao, and to some extent, Joe and I had already been talking about that. And then Whitlam said, for example, the Nanchang uprising in 1927. And I looked at Whitlam and I thought, where on earth has that come from? And he said, if I remember correctly, you, Premier Zhou Enlai, were the leader of that uprising. And Joe said, yes, I was. And it was adventurous, and it was really pushed by the Soviet Union. Now, I had not talked about that since we'd established diplomatic relations. I had, however, given him briefing material back in that earlier visit in 1971, which happened to include some material on the history of the Chinese Communist Party. And this small but quite significant fact had remained in his mind, and you know, it came out like that. And that's and there are thousands of examples of how his memory served him really well. There was only one occasion when I saw him, when I saw that memory slip. In the same meeting with Mao, they got into talking about revolution and evolution. And Mao asked Whitlam if his party, the Labour Party, would dare to make revolution. And Whitlam said, oh, we believe in evolution. And this then led to a discussion about Charles Darwin. And Mao asked Whitlam if the city of Darwin was named after Charles Darwin, and did Charles Darwin ever visit that city in his ship, the Beagle? That's when Whitlam's memory slipped. And he said, the city was certainly named after Charles Darwin, yes, but, and then after some hesitation, he thought Darwin had visited there. A few days after he was back in Australia, I received the following telegram from him. You have to remember that Whitlam was a stickler for detail and fact, and it would really worry him when he couldn't remember something or he got something wrong, which was really rare. But he also had a fine sense of humor and irony. And here's the telegram he sent me. Apropos my conversation with Chairman Mao, you should know that in 1836, Charles Darwin visited Australia as official naturalist aboard HMS Beagle, landed at Sydney on 12th of January, and visited Bathurst. On the next voyage in 1839, the Beagle, without Darwin, visited Darwin Harbour, which the captain named after Darwin. And Whitlam went on to me, please make full confession of error to Chairman Mao and Premier Zhou Enlai, and say that with the chairman's help, I shall now follow the correct line. It was a lovely political joke, if you like. I owe a huge amount to Whitlam, his leadership and his ideas, and the fact that he had such confidence in me to ask me to go to Beijing as ambassador. Jing, you also asked me, why is China important to Australia? Now, for me, that seems obvious, but I accept that it's not obvious to everyone. And I think, of course, it's hugely important. And it's not just the trade or the diplomacy. It's because China is a very big and very important civilization, regardless of what the politics of the day are. And it's a huge influence on us and on our region. Back in 2017, I gave the Whitlam Oration for the Whitlam Institute. It was titled Living in a Chinese World. And a lot of people couldn't understand that. And a lot of people afterwards were in denial about that. No, we're not living in a Chinese world. But you could see it already, that the spread of the influence. And this is an example, by the way, of China's soft power in Southeast Asia. They haven't been driving any kind of military action on the Southeast Asian mainland or in the archipelago, but the influence is everywhere and obvious. And one of the most obvious signs of this is the spread of Chinese language, of Mandarin Chinese, When I first went to Southeast Asia back in the 1960s, it was quite difficult to find people who spoke Mandarin Chinese. But now, if you go to Southeast Asia, anyway, it's all around you. In fact, a person from China would be able to get on a plane, arrive in a Southeast Asian country, probably speak Chinese all the way through customs and immigration, and stay in a place where Chinese is spoken and do all the kinds of activities that you might do as a tourist or a trader within the Chinese language. So that's just one example, but you can see it in many other ways, like movies and so on. It's a bit like we've been living in an American world. The influence of Hollywood, for example, is pretty universal, or has been. Now, there's a rather similar cultural influence of China in our region. So why is Australia important to us? It's because it is becoming a dominant force in our region, and we have to come to terms with it. Whatever we might think of its political system, and we have to talk with it. We have to remember, speaking about the political system, that back in 1972, when we established relations, the political system in China was not all that attractive, to say the least. And yet, we considered it important, really important, to develop a relationship with that country. And that's what we set out to do and did. And I'm delighted at how it developed after that, although not quite so much about what happened in recent years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stephen, for this wonderful presentation, wonderful talk. To me and to many people, you are like a treasure house. You just have so many treasures. Anything you bring up, it's really eye-opening. Wow, never heard of this before. So it's really wonderful. Now, I have more questions, actually, for Steve. So anyone else in the audience, if you like to have your questions to be asked to Stephen, you can put into the Q&A at the function at the bottom of the screen. And at the end of my conversation with Stephen, I will collect your questions. We will have some minutes to get your questions. So my first question starts from the very beginning, as you have just mentioned. These days, running to Chinese and the people who speak Chinese are everywhere. But when your My China story started, it really started with a blank sheet. And as John mentioned in the introduction, you grew up in Hobart, Tasmania. In those days of Tasmania, you didn't even know a single Asian person. And when you were sent to the Royal Australian Air Force Language School to learn Chinese by the Department of Foreign Affairs, you didn't know anyone who spoke Chinese. You know, so looking back, what do you think that helped you into Chinese language, which, as we know, is a very complex language to learn? And my next question is, what foresights did you have that motivate you to want to be a China specialist as early as in the 1960s?
Well, to take the second part of that question first, what motivated me? I should say that it was not my idea to learn Chinese. When I arrived in Canberra to join what was then the Department of External Affairs, on day one, I was told, you will learn Chinese, like that. And that kind of mapped out the next several years. You know, I was told I would do it part-time at the ANU during our training year. I would then go for intensive language at Point Cook and then to Hong Kong. So that was, if you like, almost involuntary on my part. But as I went on studying the language and reading myself into modern and contemporary Chinese history and politics, I became more and more engaged with this. And I actually, I came to a point where I decided I would like to make my career with this, of going deeply into the study of China, trying to understand it, trying to get on top of the language. And so that's what I did. Yes, Chinese is language is a bit of a challenge, but I didn't find it so much because, you know, I was doing Chinese intensively. I find the language quite fascinating. And I love the written language. I think that's really fun when you're learning it, to get to a point where you actually can look at one of these characters and understand how it's made up, the composition and so on. In any event, I can't claim foresight at that stage, I certainly at that stage did become committed to become a China specialist.
I'm sure many people were asked to learn a language but not ended up doing so. That takes a lot, you know, more than effort, and I think, you know, to get into a language in such a deep way. My next question is, you, as we know, that you were appointed by Gough Whitlam to this very highly competitive position, the first Australian ambassador to China when the relationship was established. At the end of your term in China, so we'll go backwards, you were suggested to be the ambassador to Japan. You decided not to take it up because you were convinced that mastering the language and all the background knowledge of the country was vital in playing an effective role as an ambassador. Can you elaborate more on this conviction? And can you give us an example to show how you wouldn't have been able to fulfill your role of the ambassador to China effectively if you hadn't had that in-depth knowledge of Chinese language, history, culture, political system that enable you to get it right?
Can I say first that from the time I resigned from the Foreign Service in 1966 until the time I went to Beijing as ambassador, I became very deeply involved with other people in the Asian languages and studies field in promoting the idea that this is what we needed for Australia, and that languages had to be introduced to our universities and schools, Asian languages, and that language was an opening to the culture and being able to understand the culture and enjoy the culture, but also for other purposes. So I had a very strong commitment that people in whatever their profession should really be expert in the country in which they work. Now, having said that, I will certainly want to acknowledge that I've known many Australian diplomats and diplomats from other countries who haven't had that capacity. But in the Australian case, I've known many who were brilliant diplomats without having that. But for me, it was really a very deeply held conviction, so that I would have felt, and by the way, the suggestion that I might go to Tokyo was made by Fraser's foreign minister, Andrew Peacock. I would have felt, I think, uncomfortable and out of my depth. There's a part of the reason is you don't know what's going on if you don't have the language and all of that. And there's a lovely anecdote which is told by John Menadue, a a very important figure in Australian officialdom and public life over a long, long time. And at one stage, he was ambassador in Japan. No, sorry, it's afterwards. He became the CEO of Qantas. And they had an office in Tokyo, and the office was run by an Australian. And on one visit to Tokyo, John stumbled across a quite interesting phenomenon. There were really two offices. There was the office that operated in English, and there was the office that operated in Japanese. And those who were operating in English had no idea what was going on amongst and by those who were working in notionally the Japanese office. And that, I mean, that's a good example of how something can be absolutely out of kilter if you don't have those skills. And just being able to talk in important work situations in someone's language often results in a different and more positive and constructive result. I'll give you an example of that. First time I met Premier Zhou Enlai after I arrived in Beijing in 73, we talked about many things, but we talked about Bangladesh. And Bangladesh had recently become, had broken away. Had been part of Pakistan, and it had broken away and become an independent state. And Australia had been the very first country to grant it diplomatic recognition. And a part of my brief was to speak to China about that and see if we could get them to recognize too. And the problem was that China had had very close relations with Pakistan. And so I had, in this late night meeting with Zhou Enlai, I put the Australian point of view, he put the Chinese point of view. Then when the meeting was over, it was around about midnight, we're walking along this dimly lit corridor, as they were in those days, and he suddenly said to me, stopped and said to me in Chinese, "Believe me, we will recognize Bangladesh in due course, but I hope you'll understand that we can't do it immediately or precipitately." Now, that kind of thing, I think, has only said, well, not only, but in a certain kind of situation where people feel at ease with each other in the language, do you get that opportunity? So that's really what that was all about, why I was so passionate.
Yeah, it's such a great example and so telling. In relation to this, and my next question is about cultural revolution. I mean, many people are familiar with the term cultural revolution, but it's actually quite difficult to explain what the cultural revolution is really about without adapting it to a simplistic version of the event. You had a three-week trip across China in January 1968 at the height of the cultural revolution, as John mentioned, and I witnessed what China was like during that unique, very China-specific period. At one point, when a New Zealand student was found to have discarded Chairman Mao's memorabilia into a waste basket and was immediately denounced by a group of Red Guards as a class enemy. To save that student and the situation, you definitely pulled out your quotation from Chairman Mao, "Mao Zhuxi Yu Lu," and found and read out the relevant quote: "Without investigation and study, one does not have a right to speak. 没有调查研究就没有发言权." I read that story, it's amazed. So, yeah. And How did that first-hand experience impact on your views of China? And what insights did you gain from that unique and almost surreal, but incredibly authentic experience during that trip?
Yes, I should say that while it might have seemed smart at the time, it was not very smart because the Red Guards became infuriated with me quoting Chairman Mao back at them. And so they turned on me as well as the New Zealand student, and I became an enemy of China as well. And they, the room had filled up with these Red Guards, and the person who seemed to be a leader turned to them at one point and said, "What shall we do with them?" And first people were shouting up, make them bow their heads and confess to their crime. And then someone said, "We will take them to the stadium in Changsha and have a trial before the masses of Changsha, and they will be sentenced to death." Now, fortunately, the People's Army arrived at that point. And as they reached forward to grab us, suddenly they pulled back. And I didn't know what happened at first. But anyway, soon I saw there were army people at the door. What did that did that sour me? No. It just made me acutely aware of how little we understood about China, about what was going on in the Cultural Revolution and the origins of that, and more deeply, the deeper roots of the Chinese Communist Party in modern history and so on. And it strengthened my conviction that Australians had to really get to know China. And so the day after I left China, I wrote to my parents and said a bit about all of this experience, and said, you know, I'm now going to dedicate myself to trying to get all the study that we can possibly get into the schools and universities in Australia so that we can better understand this huge, giant country. So in that way, it was a very constructive experience.
Yeah, it does give you insight into the complexities of China and the Chinese political system and society.
Yeah,
my next question jumped to Gough Whitlam made his first visit to China as the opposition leader in 1971, when the Cold War was in full swing. And for many Australians, as you mentioned, China was perceived as a threat, a more sinister threat than Soviet Union. You described Whitlam's visit as a visit that is nothing in Australian history to compare with. What were the key factors you think that led to the success of Whitlam's visit?
Well, I think the most important in many ways is that China was ready. The Cultural Revolution had been a pretty traumatic experience all around. And during that period, China had become quite isolated internationally. And Premier Zhou Enlai, who had tried to salvage something of China's foreign relations during the Cultural Revolution, found an opportunity at this stage to kind of reach out. So there was an opening going on, and that so he was very receptive to the approach that came from the Australian Labor Party. And in saying that, I should also take this opportunity to say, I think when we Australians talk about our relations with China and how it's developed, we tend pretty overwhelmingly to talk about the Australians involved. And not so much about the people on the Chinese side and the roles that they played. And I think that's something that is missing from our histories of Australia-China relations, the ones written in English anyway, or written by Australians. So that was a factor. A second factor, Whitlam was that Whitlam had read the signs because, as I mentioned earlier, he was really knowledgeable about and on top of trends in international affairs and had seen there was had been signs that the Americans were about to shift. He didn't know, of course, about the Kissinger visit, but he believed that he was on the right side of history and that the Americans were going to shift. Then in that famous meeting with Zhou Enlai, he was able to, as it were, match Zhou in discussion and debate. So it was in no way an unequal discussion. And another factor was that it was normally the case that when a foreign leader met with a Chinese leader, not only in China, it happened in many countries, that the media is allowed in for the initial exchange of pleasantries, and they take photos and then they're asked to leave. On this occasion, Joe had asked the media, including there were about a dozen Australian media with us. He asked them to remain. So there was the Australian media and Chinese media throughout. Now, the importance of this was that the media reports going back to Australia had quite an effect on public opinion at home. It was about the performance of Whitlam, which was much praised, but it was also importantly about Zhou Enlai. And before this happened, the images that many Australians had of Chinese in the PRC were, as though they were some kind of red devils with horns or something like that. So here was Zhou Enlai, a most sophisticated, intelligent person and diplomatic who at no stage did he become in any way propagandist. There was none of that. It was all straightforward. And the media could see this, and that was reflected in their reporting. And so when we got back to Australia, there was the beginning of a complete turnaround in public opinion about China, and a growing enthusiasm about establishing diplomatic relations. So that was a factor in making it a success.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm hanging on to every single word you said. It's so insightful and it's so, it's incredible. And your four-year term as the Australian ambassador, incredible, it was packed with so many unprecedented events of huge historical significance, including Cultural Revolution, Whitlam's visit to China as the first Australian Prime Minister, dismissal of a Whitlam government, denouncing Confucius and the Lin Biao campaign, Peeling People, death of Zhou Enlai, Malcolm Fraser's visit to China, the Great Tangshan earthquake, and death of Mao Zedong, and the fall of Gan of Four. The list is unbelievable in 4 years. In Whitlam's second visit to China, and this time as a prime minister, and let me first give a small detail. In the lead up to this visit, you went to the airport in Beijing to greet a Murray Grey Bull named Saber Bogong, a gift to China. Yes. Yeah. And during the visit, an unscheduled meeting with the chairman Mao Zedong occurred. In a way you describe it, it feels like watching a suspense movie. The meeting only included Whitlam and you. My question is, did you have any anticipation that this would happen? And also, like, like us, you had watched and read about Mao Zedong and you read quotations of Chairman Mao, Mao Zedong Lu. How did you feel and how did you found what Chairman Mao Zedong was like when you actually met him in person? And by the way, you are the only person I know who has met Chairman Mao. And this person is an Australian.
We didn't know it was going to happen, but in my discussions with the foreign ministry about the program, we had requested a call on Chairman Mao. And every time I went to the ministry, we'd run through the things and there'd be a gap. And I'd say, what's that? And they'd say, that's a gap. So I guess that they were, pardon me, reserving some space for a possible meeting with Chairman Mao. But I think because Mao was not in good health at that time, they didn't want to commit. But also it was characteristic of the way Chinese organized these high-level meetings. They didn't tell you till the last minute. I mean, that had happened with us back in 1971 with Zhou and I. I also, when I met Chiang Kai-shek in Taiwan with an Australian parliamentary delegation, a similar kind of thing happened. It came like out of the blue. So I had requested it. It was not scheduled in the program. But that day we were having talks with Premier Zhou and I. And two unusual things. One, Joe never worked with paper. It was all out of his head. But that afternoon, he had a small satchel. And it was not for his talks with Whitlam. While he's talking across the table with Whitlam, he kept looking at this satchel and shuffling through some papers. And I'll explain the significance of that afterwards. But and then the chief of protocol kept coming in and out and whispering in his ear. And then at one point, he suddenly stood up and said to Whitlam across the table, can I have a word with you? And Whitlam looked a bit nonplussed because he thought, well, we're having a word. He stood up and he followed Joe over to a side of this very big room, and they sat in the two armchairs. What happened was that he was discussing the visit to Mao, and Whitlam was putting it to him that I should accompany him. Now, in those days, Chinese officials they were very protective of Mao, which, you know, can be understood. And they didn't like anyone except the leading person to go alone. The person sitting beside me was the head of foreign affairs, and he wrote on my pad, what's going on? And I wrote on the pad, Mao, perhaps, ? When Whitlam came back and sat down, he saw my pad and he wrote underneath, FitzGerald, perhaps. So I knew at that stage that it was going to be a meeting with Mao, and that I was to go with it. And, you know, then a little while later, we were taken away in separate cars, by the way, into Zhongnanhai for the meeting with Mao. What was my impression? In a way, it was a little bit difficult to separate my knowledge of this person and the role he had played in China over the period since the 1920s. It was quite an occasion. He stood up. By the way, he was not well at this stage, he stood up to greet Whitlam and then me. And they had briefed him to what kind of things he should say to Whitlam. And about me, they'd briefed him too, and they'd said that, you know, I had been an academic, and, you know, I'd have been working on China for my PhD. And he said, you are a great scholar. So I had my own quotation from Chairman Mao, if you like. But after we sat down and talked, it was apparent that, you know, he was really not at all well. The first 20 minutes particularly, after that, he brightened up. So I assumed that they'd given him something to, you know, get him going. And he began asking questions. One of the people there was a man called Wong Hung Wen, who became known as one of the Gang of Four. And he had just been made a deputy chair of the Chinese Communist Party. And Whitlam commented to Mao, he said, "I'm very pleased to meet Wong Hung Wen. He must be very talented at his age." He was very young, to have become a deputy leader of the Chinese Communist Party. And Whitlam said, "Where did you find him?" And Whitlam, Mao, who was facing this way towards the interpreter, and Wong Hung Wen was sitting over there, he heard the interpreting, and he slowly moved his head around, and he looked at Wong Hung Wen. And then he said, "Well, put it up. I don't know." It was a remarkable moment, I have to say. Nevertheless, they did manage to have a conversation about nuclear testing. And as I mentioned earlier, about revolution and evolution and many other things. It was a very impressive event.
Well, we definitely should add two quotations to Chairman Ma. "You are a good scholar," and the other one, "I don't know." You know, so. Of many accounts of events in your memoir that I found fascinating and enlightening, so one particular event stands out, particularly for me, an Italian filmmaker, Michelangelo Antonio Leoni's documentary, China. Growing up in China in the 1970s, I remember clearly there was a national campaign against Antonioni's film, denouncing it for smearing China. Although no one I knew of had actually watched the film, I only watched it when I came to Australia in 1988. It actually made me feel very nostalgic. I found that it's a very moving documentary. What we didn't know back then in China is in May 1974, ABC decided to show the documentary, and Sydney and Melbourne film festivals also scheduled the showing. Chinese government demanded Australian government to stop the showing. You reiterated that Australian government had no power to do that and explained how freedom of information and speech worked in Australia. You said, "This is the first time we've had a direct dispute that goes to a fundamental difference between our political systems and how we each see the world and are conducted between states." And you also said it needed a lot of calm to deal with that. Do you see this fundamental difference, the biggest challenge in our engagement with China and the biggest challenge in drawing support from Australian public in engaging China?
It was certainly very challenging. I had arranged a dinner for the Australian. We had resident journalists in Beijing, and they were having great difficulty getting access and getting to go to places, go on visits. They couldn't even see that Murray Grey bull, Saber Bogong. And when one of them asked, "Well, where is the bull?" And a foreign ministry official said, "I suggest you try the zoo We went to the restaurant where we were entertaining, and we waited and waited and waited. And the Chinese officials we had invited just never turned up. Next day, I went to the foreign ministry and I raised this. They looked me in the eye and said, we didn't get any invitation. And yet it had all been recorded and so on. And I understand the pressures that they were under. And by the way, years later, when I was in Beijing, I had a meeting with some foreign ministry people, and one, a man called Ma, who was in the information department of the foreign ministry, actually apologized to me for that. He said, we stood you up, we know that that was not right, we understand your position. But was this the biggest issue we had to deal with? Not really at that time. I mean, we didn't often have those kind of things. The political culture, to some extent. So it was not always easy to get appointments with officials in ministries outside the foreign ministry. That certainly was one of the most difficult things. It was not easy to get access at a very high level. You had to work really hard at each small step. How did it influence the Australian public at home? I don't think it had much influence at all, because, as I mentioned earlier, back in 71, after that visit by Whitlam and all the reporting of the media, there had been an almost complete turnaround in public opinion about China, which in time evolved into a kind of euphoria about the relationship. Everyone who was anyone in Australia wanted to come to China. We were besieged with requests to facilitate visits by this group and that group, right across the board. So I don't think that episode or other kind of difficulties really impacted on public opinion. And for us in the embassy, you just had to be able to see past those problems because of cultural differences and the obstacles that they sometimes created in order to find the connections and keep the relationship going.
I have to skip a few questions and come to the last one. Oh, very unfortunate. We have so much to talk about. The last question is on the topic of intercultural communication. And I think you'd agree with me that humor, which you have great sense of humor, I so enjoy, is the ultimate test for intercultural competence. Because humor is includer when it can be shared, and excluder when people don't have the cultural fluency to join in. Do you still remember the first Chinese joke you understood? And what is your favorite Chinese joke?
Okay, you asked me this before. So I do remember the first Chinese joke I actually understood. It was told to me by one of my teachers in Hong Kong. It was based on grammar and punctuation. And he said there was this man who lived in a Beijing lane, a hutong, and people were always peeing or urinating against his wall. And he became very annoyed about this. So he painted in very big characters. And I'll see if I can share this. How do I share this?
Share screen?
Yeah. Can you see that?
And if you click on share screen.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, now we can see it.
You can see
it? Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. So he put these characters on the outside of his wall. That's people and dogs may not urinate here. 人狗等不得再次小便。And then someone came along and changed it, and it became 人狗等不得再次小便。It became people and dogs. If you can't wait, pee here. And that's the first time I ever understood a joke in Chinese. I don't have a favorite Chinese joke, but there's one that I love, which I didn't hear at the time, but only after the event. It concerned my name, my name in Chinese, which is Fei Si Fen. That character, Fen, is not usual, very unusual, particularly with the wood radical underneath the Fen. And every time my name appeared in the People's Daily, they had to, you know, get a new character to put that there. But I learned years after I had been ambassador that people in the Ministry of Foreign Trade had a lot of fun with my name. And Fei Si Fen, and they used to call me something which sounded very close, but was very different. Fei Si Fen, which is means prickly heat powder. And I thought that was great. When I heard about it, I thought it was great fun. And I was actually delighted that at that time, when things often seemed very stitched up and straight-laced, that people could be having a lovely joke about my name in Chinese. So
that's excellent. It shows a lot about the play of words. So you do have to know Chinese very well to get that. It's excellent. Thank you so much. We run over time, which is not surprising because, Stephen, you just have so many stories and that we really want to hear more about. And I can't thank you enough, Professor Stephen FitzGerald, for this wonderful session and my China Stories special edition. And I cannot stand, and I see why, and how you have been so loved and so dearly loved, by so many of your Chinese friends and colleagues, because you have really won our heartfelt respect. Your knowledge of China is incredible. And thank you again. And thank you, John and Whitlam Institute, for the support. And lastly, also thank you, my assistant Lindsay Liu and Yan Yi Liu. And thank you, audience, for your participation. Lastly, I just can't recommend this book, Stephen's memoir, highly enough. It's a wonderful, wonderful read. Whether you are interested in China or you are Chinese, you get lots of details, and it's so rich with historical events and details. It's wonderful. And Stephen, as you can see now, has a great sense of humor, and he told those stories in such an interesting way, very engaging. So we are very pleased that our last major event of 2022 has ended on this very high note. My China Story series will come back in 2023 with a very diverse guest speakers. Thank you again, Stephen, and thank you, John, and thanks, everyone. Have a good evening.
Thank you.